Can be having a good day, and the smallest thing can take us away from that good day. We can be having a bad day, and the smallest thing can take us bad day to a good day. Now that's never going to change. Our emotions will ebb and flow, rise and fall. They will be good, they will be bad. They will lie to us, teach us things that are not true, make us feel things that are not true. They will deceive us. And so we must take all of the thoughts and feelings and so-called realities of our lives every single moment, and we must arrest them. We must hold them captive to the truth of Jesus Christ, who is the truth. I mean, the mere weather can make us feel a little blah. Our singing today was not as powerful as it was last week. Because last week the sun was shining. It wasn't as cool. Today is one of those days where it'd be better fitted to stay in bed. Snuggle up with a blanket or a fire or pet or hot chocolate or whatever it is that we like to find solace in. It's amazing how overcast days and cool weather sometimes, when the sun doesn't shine, it can affect our joy. We just don't feel very good. Yet the Scripture teaches us to reflect it upon it this way. Is that Jesus faced the cross with joy. He looked beyond the pain to the glory. He looked beyond the suffering to the joy that came. By the very life of Jesus, not to ignore the explicit teaching of Scripture, which is identical, but by the very example of the life of Jesus, there is no joy that does not come through pain. Beloved, I'm glad you are here among us this morning. I'm glad that you gather together as a family today, because whatever weighs heavy upon your shoulders, the Word of God will give you hope. The prayers of your brothers and sisters will give you strength. Being honest about who we are and what we feel and what we're experiencing is an opportunity for the rest of us to minister to each other. We're able to come to the throne of grace with our face lifted high, because Jesus, the God-man, paid for our sins so that the judge of all judges has nothing against us. Nothing. Nothing. We're not partly loved by God. We're not almost righteous. We're not just a little bit on the way. We are sanctified through Jesus Christ, and that will be a journey like no journey. But one day we will see Him face to face. We shall be perfect. But until we are perfect, we are safe in Jesus Christ, because He has sealed us with the Holy Spirit. God's judgment against us has been poured out upon Jesus, so that we are now justified before Christ. How? You might ask. Because Christ has done all of the work. Salvation is all of Him. It is all of God. It is all of grace. So friends, while there may be gloom in our hearts and frustration in our minds and illness in our bodies, this is light, momentary affliction that is preparing us for an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. On the way home from Statesboro yesterday, I was listening to XM 76, and that's the classical station, and with hopes that it would put everybody to sleep. It did not. It doesn't work like that often. Beethoven's last full symphony that he composed, Symphony number 9, Opus 125, Symphony number 9 in D minor. It is the one where we know as the chorale or the ode to joy. It's the first time anyone composed a symphony with a chorus in it. And as I sat there and I listened to this native tongue sing a very known tune to me, even in its original language, I'm very familiar with it. I performed it myself. But as I hear it, and it doesn't touch what worship should be in our hearts. And I thought to myself, of all the times I've sat preparing to see a symphony play or sat before the opening of an opera and I just hear the orchestra tuning to itself. And you hear that first violin give the concert C or the concert A, depending on what they're playing. And then everybody starts to tune. And it sounds like a bunch of cats walking through a garden of bells and microwaves and toddlers. Yeah. Just a bunch of little... And then the conductor stands up and he taps once and he holds. And depending on how you conduct, some people conduct very strangely. But once you learn how a conductor moves the sound from this orchestra, you can follow it. And he stands there and everyone there, all these pieces, who even by themselves can make good music, is nothing compared to the ensemble. And you could hear a pin drop. And between the movements of the symphony, I contemplated what it must be like in glory, as a pin could drop in the presence of Christ, as the conductor of our joy stands before us and raises the baton of His grace, and we sing praises to His name. The chill of just that physical experience brings me to tears when I hear the opening chord of an orchestra. When I hear a French sonnet being sung, just the beauty of what human beings can do with the creativeness that God has given them, it sends me into a place of experience that is indescribable. There is no poetry that could flow from my mouth that could give you the description of what I feel and experience when I hear good music. But oh, how disturbingly weak and disgusting and ridiculous and worthless that shall be in comparison to the glorious chorus of "Worthy is the Lamb" that we shall sing together on that day. And there will be no gloomy weather. There will be no election. There will be no sickness. There will be no infighting. There will be nothing to hinder the joy of our expression. There will be nothing to stand in the way of us truly, with all of our spirit, with all of our mind, with all of our soul, and with all of our strength, together in unison, worshiping Jesus Christ, who is worthy of all praise. Ne'er will there ever be anything, whether a lawn to be cut, or a car to be washed, or a child to be bathed, ever stand in the way of the eternal worship that is due our God. So, beloved, when we see the days like today, when there is just an oppressiveness about our emotions, let us be glad, for there is a day that is coming where these things will disappear. So until then, let us not live for this world. Let us not love this world. Let us not exist for the sake of this world. Do not grow and build treasures for this earth. Do not stand and leave a legacy of footnotes and worthlessness in this life. Do not think you are making a difference in this world when the only difference that is ever going to be made in the mark of history is that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the Son of Man, came to redeem a people. And if you are not in the counted number, you will not stand. You will be an obliterated nothing for all of eternity. But glory be to God, He saved us. We don't have to worry about what we shall do, for Christ has done it all. We do not have to worry about how we shall stand, for Christ has stood for us on the cross. And when He finished His work, as we see in Scripture, He sat down at the right hand of the Father. And when He receives us unto Himself, He stands to receive His own. Beloved, Christ is ready for you, whether you're ready for Him or not, because He has made you righteous. God has declared you just. And there is something worth singing about when we know that truth. There is not an argument, hurt, harm, or pain that can stand in the way of such joy. Turn with me to 2 Thessalonians. Chapter 1, verse 5. Follow with me through verse 10. This is the evidence of the righteous judgment of God, that you may be considered worthy of the kingdom of God, for which you are also suffering. Since indeed God considers it just to repay with affliction those who afflict you, and to grant relief to you who are afflicted as well as to us, when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, inflicting vengeance on those who do not know God and on those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. They will suffer the punishment of eternal destruction away from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his might. And when he comes on that day to be glorified in his saints, and to be marveled at among all who have believed, because our testimony to you was believed. Let's pray. Lord, this word is so true. Allow it to arrest us, to seize us, to capture us, to mold us, to break us, to grow us, to shape us. Father, let us consider ourselves as we sit this day under the teaching of this word, and let us consider how we stand before you. Are we trusting in works? Are we trusting in self-righteousness? Are we trusting in our faith, of our faith? Are we trusting in anything? Are we trusting in our ability of lordship? Are we trusting in ourselves? Lord, help us to see that there is no hope except in Christ, that we might forsake our self-reliance and rest in Him. And Lord, let us not only contemplate ourselves, let us look deeply into the hearts of those around us as we know each other intimately to some degree, and help us to pray for one another that we would all be filled with all your fullness, that our joy would be full in Jesus Christ, that our hunger would not be for relationship or glory or worldly pursuits or ministry, but our hearts for each other. Our prayer is that we would pray that each other's hearts will be drawn to your word and powerfully affixed to the affection of your Son, Jesus the righteous. And finally, Father, as we pray, let us contemplate those in our lives and those not in our lives that exist outside the world, in the world, outside the protection of your grace, of the sealing of your Spirit. Father, those who are perishing this very moment, let us pray that you would use us as an instrument of power, an instrument of grace, an instrument of hope, as we preach to the lost, as we preach to the weary, as we preach to the doubting, as we preach to the wicked about your saving grace. Give us lives that are exemplary, that give a testimony in themselves, but Father, let that testimony be true as we preach the gospel of Jesus. Lord, we pray that for ourselves and for each other. And we pray that your Spirit would open the eyes of unbelievers, that they may see and savor the beauty of Jesus Christ the Son. And as we take this word into our ears today, as we take this word into our hearts, Father, if you do not prepare our ears and hearts, it is futile. So, Lord, I pray desperately, I beg of you, Lord, by your sovereign grace, would you please work in me and each other and all of us the power of your word, so that we might stand and celebrate your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. This is the same text that I preached last week, and in part the text that I preached 2 weeks prior to that. But inside of this text, there's several arguments that are made congruently. And so this morning, I want us to think about several things. And in the beginning, I want you to have your mind set on some things that philosophically and argumentatively are a little off. Let me just tell you what they are. I want you to think about two negative aspects of this text, the two negative aspects that Paul teaches here to the Thessalonians. There's the negative aspect of there are people who are rejected by God. That's negative. I mean, everybody likes, and I mentioned last week in the opening to my sermon that there are people who would say that I'm a hellfire brimstone preacher. That's not the case. Any preacher who does not preach the full counsel of the Word of God by preaching God's righteousness is actually lying. Let me tell you how easy that is. When you consider the felt needs of a people, of a city, of a congregation, and you start thinking, well, this is not going to make them feel good. Let's encourage them and build them up. And we think that the absence of negative is the presence of positive. If I'm drinking poison and you go, I just don't want to hurt his feelings, he really enjoys that drink. Isn't that wicked? The same would be true if I ignored the very aspect of the fact that Paul is saying that the judgment of God is coming. Oh heavens, Betsy, that encouraging letter to the Roman Christians. How in the world has this set the tone for encouragement when he starts out that the wrath of God is going to be poured out on all unrighteousness? All who suppress the knowledge of the truth by unrighteous works. And then not only is God going to pour out all of His wrath upon unrighteousness who suppress the truth by their unrighteous works, He's then going to turn them over to a reprobate mind to do that which is unnatural. And then, in sense, build a case against them even worse than there already is. So that when He destroys them for all of eternity, punitively, judicially, He's glorified in it and we worship Him for doing so. Wow, what a positive message, Paul. Thanks. Same is true here. To the two negative aspects of this text is that there is rejection of God, rejection by God toward groups of people, and that there, because of that, there is the judgment of God toward two groups of people. It's negative. There are two misapplications of this text that some people would look at and say, well, you know, this is just to show us the God of the Old Testament. We misname the God of the Old Testament often. How many times, if you just by a show of hands, you've ever heard somebody say, the God of the Old Testament is a God of vengeance. The God of the New Testament is a God of love. You ever heard that? Yeah. Hear it all the time. Well, friends, God has never not been a God of vengeance, and God has never not been a God of love. As a matter of fact, if we start to look at the reality of vengeance and the reality of love, God of the New Testament is oh so much more vengeful than the God of the Old Testament. Because in the God of the Old Testament, in His vengeance and His righteousness, He pours out justice on those who were overly guilty for what He's pouring out on them. Here's 100 years, get it right. Here's another 100 years. Get it. Here's another 100 years. We do that as parents. What did I say? One. Two. When I was a kid, it was like 2 1/4. 2 1/2. 2 3/4. And you're like running. It's like you're waiting for the guy to safe at the home plate. And that junk doesn't work. And your parents just don't really want to spank you. And they start going, 2 1/32. I mean, you know, for you mathematicians in the room. Just break it all down. Friends, it's never wrong. It's never vengeful and evil and wicked and maniacal to bring justice against those people who deserve it. What could be considered maniacal? What could be considered wrong? What can be considered unfair is that Jesus Christ, the holy, righteous one of God, suffered the consequence of sin that He did not do. So don't tell me the God of the New Testament is a God of love when He destroyed the very essence of love. Why did He do that? Because He's a God of righteousness. He's a God of judgment. So in order for God to forgive us, there must be judgment against us that's satisfied. Propitiation, Brother Doug prayed this morning. That's what the word means. So with these two negative aspects and these two misapplications that the God of the Old Testament is wrathful and vengeful and the God of the New Testament is merciful, there's three false assumptions that I think that are always at play in the text like this. And there's probably more, but there are three certainly. And here they are. Some people like to say, God won't judge me. He's too, what? Loving. He's too merciful. God is love. Well, if God is love, then the love is pure. And if the love is pure, the love is righteous. And if the love is righteous, the love cannot give affection and mercy toward those who are unrighteous. So for someone to say, well, God won't judge me, He's too merciful. It's funny how when we say, hey, there's a building on fire over there, nobody says, don't judge that building. Don't judge. Just because that building's got smoke coming out, somebody could be cooking bacon. Don't judge that cook. But we say, hey, you know, somebody just committed grievous sin. Don't judge them. That's God's business. Now, God's already judged us, y'all. He's already passed judgment. The consequence of the sentence of that judgment has yet to come, which is death and eternal damnation. But the free gift of God is what? Eternal life through Christ Jesus, to be received how? Striving and pushing and working? No, faith. It's believe that God has accomplished it. We put our trust in the accomplishment of God. We put our faith in Jesus Christ every moment, all the time. Not last week, not last year, not 10 years from now, not tomorrow, but now. Another false assumption is that some people are so lost in their own minds, they say, well, God will never save me. God's never going to save me. He's too vengeful. You don't know what I've done. You ever heard somebody say that? I hear it all the time. Matter of fact, I hear those equally amongst the community. God can't save me. I'm bad. And I said, well, you're better off than the guy I just talked to who said God can't judge him because he's good. And that's the third false assumption. God won't judge me because I'm pretty good. God's not going to pass judgment on me because I'm in church. God's not going to pass judgment on me because I'm a pastor. God's not going to pass judgment on me because I was baptized. I had a guy named Jeremiah who was homeless. When I used to do open-air preaching in Savannah back in 1995, 96, 97, 98. And it was harsh down there. You stand out on the street corner and you wear a suit. I wore suits all the time. I always wore suits. It's just, I don't know why, I just always wore suits. Didn't get my first pair of blue jeans until I was like 27. And this guy named Jeremiah, he's always waiting on me that day. And he was always, and he'd come up to me and say, hey, Brother James, Jeremiah, how are you? He says, I was baptized 2 years ago. He said that every day. And Jeremiah, what did we talk about last week? He said, yeah, but I need some food. I said, well, let me go buy you some food. No, I just need to get it myself. What he wanted is money for drugs. Just want money. Now, I'm going to go get you some food. So I'd show up with food, he'd throw it in the trash. And I'd talk to him about the gospel. I'd share. He'd sit there and watch me preach. He'd watch me go door to door to the businesses and preach in the business. And laundromats, oh, heaven help. You ever been in a laundromat? Laundromat's a good place to preach, son, until the owner shows up. Hey, y'all washing your clothes? Why are you washing your clothes? They're dirty. You know what? Is your heart dirty? Is your life dirty? Is your mind dirty? Are you a sinner before God? Well, I don't think so. Well, I think you are. Why don't you get in the washing machine and see if you can make yourself clean? It's a good opener. All of us are dirty before God. Jeremiah put his hope in the fact that he was baptized 3 years ago. And I preached down there for 4 years, and it was always the same thing. I was baptized 3 years ago. 5 years later, I was baptized 3 years ago. That was his stick. That was his hope. He was baptized. He puts his hope in what he did to follow through some precepts. Just like many of us, we sit here secure. And we should sit secure if our faith is in Jesus Christ alone. We should sit very secure. But oftentimes, here's where we're going to get by the time we get through with the sermon today. A lot of us are secure in our own hearts because our neighbors and our family members and the lost people of our community say they're secure, and we just accept it because we don't want to engage it. Well, friends, there are many false assumptions about the justice of God. Let's be sure that we're not believing them in ourselves, and let's also make sure that we're not accepting them as an excuse not to engage in the gospel. You know how many people tell me every week they're going to be in Grace Truth services? 15, 20. I probably talk to 400 people a week, at least a minute or three. Aren't you preaching here? Dude, don't ask that question. I told a guy like that a couple of weeks ago. Don't ask that question. Y'all still got a church? Don't ask that question. Well, I'm coming. I said, this week? Yeah. All right, I'll see you at 10:15. I'll meet you at the door. Never seen that guy. Was somebody in here playing the piano yesterday? I see you tomorrow morning, Pastor. Are you here? No. Spiritual conversations, spiritual application, obedience. It comes when God renews us. When God saves us in His mercy, the fruit of salvation is the work of God. It's not the other way around. In this text, though it has some negatives, let's remember what the Scripture has taught us thus far. In verse 5, look at this. We learn that it says, "This is the evidence of the righteous judgment of God, that you may be considered worthy of the kingdom of God for which you are also suffering." Now this is the evidence is not referring back to verse 4 and 3 and 2 and 1. This is the evidence is talking about the suffering for the kingdom of God. This is the evidence of the righteous judgment of God. That God is just in His righteousness. He is good in His judgment. And God has judged it necessary for His people to suffer affliction in this world. It is good. Listen to that. Let me say it again. Another way. God has, in His good judgment, decided it was good for the church to suffer affliction. If we are to be identified with Christ in life, we are also to identify Christ in death. If we are to be identified Christ in glory, we will also be identified with Christ in what? Suffering. Because through much suffering comes glory. It's a guarantee. God, in His, according to Ephesians 3, manifold wisdom, has displayed this reality, and it is righteous, and it is true, and it is a good judgment. God is right by allowing His church to suffer affliction. Why? Because it is evidence of our adoption. You see that? These professing Christians who live this life of absolute glorious joy and who tell me they have no burden, no temptation, no suffering, no nothing, but that God is good all the time and all the time God is good. And if you get that started in some places, it never quits. You're like moonwalking out back going, okay, I'm done. Somebody else hears this, like a bullfrog starts, and then the whole swamp comes alive. If you don't know what I'm talking about, just go out one night about 2 in the morning to a swamp or a pond. Or the cicadas, or crickets, a cricket. Well, friends, yes, God is good all the time, and yes, our joy is full, and yes, we are complete in Christ, and yes, we are satisfied, and yes, we lack nothing, and yes, though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we have no fear. But friends, it is with much affliction. It is with much burden. It is through much labor. It is through much toil that we will see glory. Anybody, listen to my words, anybody who tells you that the gospel is a gospel of simplistic, easy living is a liar. If you are born of God, temptations and trials and suffering is yours in Christ. Just as glory is yours in Christ, temptation, trials, and suffering are yours in Christ. That's a reminder of last week. Verse 6 is a reminder. Remember from last week that he says there, "Since indeed God, we see then for which you are suffering, the evidence of the righteous judgment of God is that you're considered worthy because you're suffering." That shows that you're worthy. Verse 6, "Then since indeed God considers it just," the word justice and righteousness are interchangeable in meaning and application. And so it's just, it's righteous judgment that He repays with affliction those who afflict you. Now here is how we look at that sometimes. What we learned last week is that recompense is righteous judgment against those who afflict God's people. But oftentimes we want it now. Do we not? And so we're sitting around, we're not even like the martyrs in Revelation 5. And the martyrs in Revelation 6 under the throne, you know, that picture there. If you want to know what that means, come Tuesday or go on the church website and listen. All 8 weeks are up now. We like to see it now. We want to walk out of the fight and the doors swing, and as they swing, it's like a Steve McQueen movie. The whole thing blows up behind us. Got them! Told you not to mess with me. I'm God's, what is the word? Anointed. There you go. That's what we want. We want this guy who gets in our face and causes us pain. We want our neighbor whose dog never stops yapping. We want like fire to come down from heaven and the ground to swallow up the kennel. And we walk over there and say, peace be with you. I told you to silence that dog. You bothered me. We want persecution when it comes to be dealt with immediately. One of the, those of you who have numerous children, one of the frustrations as a parent with numerous children is that we can get in there sometimes and there's an infraction. You know what an infraction is? That you've done something wrong, you've said something wrong, you smell wrong, or you've looked at somebody wrongly. Either any of those things and all in between, and the other person wants justice now. So this happened. Okay, let me deal with it. You know, the car is still running. Don't run out in the driveway and almost die because you want to tell on somebody. You know, what are you doing? Why'd you run out in front of the truck? Slow down. The skid marks tear up the driveway, hit the house. Daddy, daddy, so-and-so did so-and-so and said so-and-so. Okay, let me get out of the car and, you know, you walk in. If the belt's not off, the paddle's not in hand, the scythe is not being, you know, we're not reaping people's souls. Oh, you're just not going to do anything about it. Okay, now you're on the chopping block. Now everybody's going to die. The whole house is dead now. Let's call Denise Smith and get a bunch of caskets. We're all gone. I mean, this is what we want. We want it now. We want justice now. We want to get over our feeling hurt and crushed and abused now. We want God to do something miraculous. But the Scripture doesn't teach that He's going to do that now. The Scripture says that He is right and He considers it good and righteous judgment to afflict them when? At the coming of Jesus. Solomon dealt with this. Have you ever read Ecclesiastes? If you're ever feeling like you just want to get off this boat, go read Ecclesiastes. I taught a summary of Ecclesiastes years ago. I don't know how long it was. I was too dumb to know better. But I entitled the sermon series, like 8 weeks, I entitled it, Let's Kill Ourselves. That was the title of it. Because that's what I felt like Solomon was saying. Why live? And of course, people go, you know, that was a little crude. I'm like, well, that's just the title. It's like when I preached in Brunswick out of the Revelation to the church, the letters to the seven churches. I preached, the title of the sermon series was Church for Sale. And I put it on the sign and people drove by and like they had a coronary because they thought the property was for sale. Because I put it up there, Church for Sale, just like that. Not sermon title, just Church for Sale. So I don't entitle my sermons now. It's very difficult because I might hurt your feelings. Not intentionally, this is the point. Ecclesiastes, Solomon said, there's nothing good under the sun. There's nothing new under the sun. It's all worthless. We toil, we work, we pray, we labor, we worship, we do all these things. For what? We die. What good is it? And then I try to do right, Solomon says. I try to live for the Lord. I try to do what's good, but I'm persecuted. I thought I could find happiness in wives. I thought I could find happiness in money. I thought I could find happiness in wisdom. But all of it came to nothing. It all is worthless. It's all the world. So now what? There's nothing. What does he conclude? It's all for the glory of God. It's all good because all of these things prepare him for an incredible taste of that which he's longed for all along and cannot find. Beloved, when we suffer in this life, we long for a better day. And the better day is not a good cup of coffee the next morning with peace and our dog in our lap. The better day is standing before Jesus Christ and worshiping him for all of the ineffable majesty that's due him. That's the better day. That's the better day. So God says that it's just, it's righteous judgment to afflict those people. And in verse 7, not only will they be afflicted and to grant relief, verse 7, to you who are afflicted as well as to us, so we know that we're going to have peace. We know we're going to have relief. If you have a headache and you take something for the headache, it goes away. But if you're like me, my headaches are coming back. Depends on what the trigger is. Light, sound, fatigue, caffeine, lack of caffeine, sugar, lack of sugar, hunger, lack of hunger. I hadn't had a headache in a while. Boof. It's crazy. Nobody knows the world of migraines. Doctors don't even know what they are. I think the best medicine for migraines is the ball peen therapy. You know what a ball peen is? It's a hammer with a little ball on the end of it. Knock yourself out, wake up later with a bump, headache's gone. Well, what about all this judgment? This judgment of affliction upon those who cause harm, this judgment, and I'm using the word judgment as Paul uses it here, his righteous judgment. He's judged it right to afflict those who afflict us, and he's judged it right that we will be giving what? We will be given relief. He's judged correctly. What does the Scripture teach about that? There's some questions here that we can answer based on the next three verses. We can ask the question, when will this judgment of God come? When will the judgment of God come? When will all these things be made right? When is this going to take place? Now, sadly, in our day, people like to watch the news and watch the television and watch the radio and watch social media and watch newspapers and say, oh, wow, the end has come, the judgment is here. Listen, friends, that cannot be discerned by those things. Those things cannot be told. Scripture teaches very clearly we are not to sit on our hands and wait for the justice of God, wait for the day of the Lord. We are to be actively at work, ready, sober-minded, prepared, and working for the sake of the glory of God and for the name of Christ. We ought to be investing in each other's lives. We ought to be praying. We ought to be preaching. We ought to be sharing. We ought to be worshiping. We don't sit together like at an airport terminal when everything's packed and said, oh, yep, I prayed, I worshiped, I waited, I loved, I lived, I fellowshiped. Now it's almost time. They're going to call my number anyway. We waste that time. We don't need to waste it. We need to redeem the time. We don't need to waste the time. When will the judgment of God come in all these things? Verse 7, the latter part. When the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with His mighty angels. Imagine that. You know, I like to watch storms. That's one thing I miss when we lived in the East Bay, is you never saw a storm. It rained maybe 35 days a year, and it was all within the first part of spring. And the rest of it was 68 degrees year-round, 40 degrees every night. It was beautiful, not a cloud in the sky. It was a paradise for those who like to be outside and not sweat and no bugs and no rain. But I miss thunderstorms. I like to go out when it's getting bad weather and watch it. I like to be out in the country where I can see it over an open field and you can look and everybody's like, well, aren't you scared of a tornado? No, I can see that stuff forming. I know when to go inside. You can watch it. You know when a tornado gets you? When you're binge watching a show on Netflix and you can't hear it. I'm not scared of that. I'm a little crazy about it. I actually like to go out. Now, lightning makes me a little uneasy, but as long as I can count to three, I'm staying outside. Some of us think the coming of Jesus is going to be like a storm. Oh, I heard some thunder. This thing might fall down. I better watch it. Oh, I saw some lightning. The wind's starting to blow. Oh, look at these clouds forming. Oh, is that a funnel cloud? Ah, nope, didn't make it. Well, let's see if this will come. It's not going to be like that, y'all. We're not going to be able to watch for weeks and months and years and say, oh, Jesus is coming. He's about to get here. The plane's about to land. Here he is. Yeah, let's go get him in here. You have a sign, Jesus. I mean, we're not going to be like that. We're not going to be able to watch it. We're not going to be able to anticipate it. The Scripture says that we ought to tell people that the judgment is imminent. That the righteousness of God through justice, through Jesus Christ the Son, is imminent. Today is the day of salvation, not yesterday and not tomorrow, not next week. Today is the day of salvation. Judgment will come when God is ready for judgment to come. Christ will return when God the Father has predetermined before the world began. The creatures of this world are not, God is not waiting on us to accomplish certain things before He returns. That's a joke. That's what Zeus of Greece does. Oh, they almost did the right thing. Now I gotta wait another month. God looking at his clock. Can you imagine worshiping a God like that? That's an annoying boss that you wish you had another job. Well, you're 3 minutes late. God does all that He pleases. No one speaks to His will. Everything will be perfect when Christ comes back. Immediately. Paul says to the first, like a twinkling of an eye. That's it. The judgment of God will come when Jesus Christ is revealed from heaven, and He's not alone. All the host of glory are there. People who do not believe the gospel, they can say whatever they want to say, and they can do whatever they want to do, and they can believe however they want to believe in their speaking to themselves in their mind. But they know that one day Christ will come. They know that God is righteous. Well, how will the Lord come? Look at verse 8. It says there, He will come in a flaming fire. Now, can you imagine that? When we see over in, I think it's Revelation 19, when we see Jesus, the depiction of Jesus over in, man, there's a lot of concordance in this thing. We see over there where Jesus on a white horse, the one sitting on it is faithful and true, and His righteousness He judges and makes war. His eyes are like a flame of fire, and on His head are many diadems, are many crowns, and He has a name written that no one knows but Himself. He is clothed in a robe dipped in blood, and the name by which He is called is the Word of God. Should bring John chapter 1 and 1 John 1 to mind, and Genesis 1. And the armies of heaven, arrayed in fine linen, white and pure, were following Him on white horses. From His mouth comes a sharp sword, Ephesians 6. You understand that word rhema, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. The word there is not logos, but rhema. With which to strike down the nations, and He will rule them with a rod of iron. He will tread the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God the Almighty. On His robe and on His thigh He has the name written, King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. This is Jesus, the timid lamb, coming to bring justice. This is what it means when it says that He will come in fire. In a flaming fire, inflicting vengeance. Beloved, this is not a story that we teach our children at bedtime. This is a truth that we teach them all the time. When the Scripture tells us that we spare the rod, we spoil the child, I'm not advocating beating or spanking. If that's what you so choose to do, fine. We know what abuse looks like, and we know what discipline looks like. But if we do not discipline our children to teach them consequences of wrong and the beauty of intimacy with right. See, we don't teach our children to do right by rewarding them to do right. Jesus even says that. He teaches that in Mark's Gospel, where He talks about the servant that works in the field, that works all day and slaves so hard and works. He says, what does the master say to the servant after he's worked a hard day in the field? Does he bring him in the house and say, hey, servant, put your feet up on the table and dine with me, for you've worked hard? He says, no, slave, where's my food? Did you know Jesus said that? You know what the point He's trying to make in that parable? We don't get rewarded for being righteous. This is a command of God. But we are certainly going to suffer the consequences of unrighteousness. But what is the consequence of right? What is the reward of righteousness? It's not sitting back with our feet up. It's enjoying the joy of Christ. Intimacy. If we are unified with Him, then we have intimacy with Him. If we have intimacy with Him, then we are satisfied in Him. If we're satisfied in Him, that means there's nothing else we need, nothing else we want, nothing else we long for, nothing else that's on our mind. We're okay with just Christ. 499 years ago, just a few weeks back, was the anniversary of the Protestant Reformation. Friends, these are the things going on in Luther's mind that caused him to lose it. For Jesus' sake. We don't need anything but Christ. Well, what about these icons? Don't take away people's religion. What else is there going to be? Jesus alone. Faith alone. That's it. That's all we need. The justice of God is coming. Jesus Christ is coming to judge the world. He is going to destroy every government. He's going to destroy every institution. He's going to take down every king. He's going to remove every every single head of state. There is no nation that belongs to God in righteousness. There is no government that has not been established to do good to those who are righteous and to punish evil that will not be taken from their thrones. There is not a ruling class in heaven. There is one king and he has one body and we are it or we are not it. Well, then who will suffer the judgment of God in His wrath when He comes? Look at the second half of verse 8. See these questions that this text answers? Two identifiers of those who will suffer the judgment of God in the last day. What are they? Those who do not know God and those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now see, this is where some people get really twisted up. So let me correct some things before we even get to these two statements. The obedience of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ is not walking in obedience to the law of God and thus being sanctified righteously and justified through obedience. So what is it? We'll tell you in just a minute. I just don't want you to sit here and think about that for the next 4 minutes. It's naked to sit there and think about what it's not. Those who do not know God, I say this often, and of course John is always in my heart and mind. John is there all the time. I thought Jesus, you know what I'm talking about. John's writing, Scripture, is there. It's there. What's in you? What letter is yours for your joy? Not what verse. What text? Get a text. Make this new year coming up. You want to be a resolved. Make the new year not to read the Bible 20 times. Woo! I wish you would read it 1,000. Don't be resolved to even memorize a bunch of Scripture. These are both good things. But you know what? Above all that, resolve to make a letter of the New Testament yours. And read the whole thing every day. Every day. Read the whole letter. The whole thing. And by the end of next year, you will have memorized the entire thing. Word for word, probably not. But you'll have it. Read it. Those who do not know God, Jesus in John 17 says these words, "This is eternal life, that they know You, the one true God, and the Son whom You have sent." Now I believe it's necessary to reemphasize that which is continually like a little patter of mine. If Jesus Christ, the God of heaven, said that this is eternal life, we ought to listen to what He has to say. Jesus is also the one who says, "Not everyone who confesses or says to Me or calls Me Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven." This calling Jesus our Lord is a declaration of intimacy, a declaration of authority. And it feeds into the second thing about obeying the gospel. Friends, we can say that Jesus is our Lord, and we can live as though He is, and we can act as though He is, and we can obey righteously as though He is, and we can do all sorts of things, and we can believe that this righteous act of obedience and placing Christ on the throne of our life is what works for our justification, but it does not. Knowing God is a work of God. How is it? When Paul would argue in Romans, he would say these words, that our throat is an open grave. Do you know that? What does that mean? Well, what use is a grave anyway? What use is an open grave? In Romans chapter 3, as it is written in verse 11, Psalm 14, Psalm 5, there's a bunch of different places that this comes from. Paul recapitulates and summarizes many places. And he says these words, "None is righteous, no, not one. No one understands. No one seeks for God. All have turned aside. Together they have become worthless. No one does good, not even one. Their throat is an open grave. They use their tongues to deceive. The venom of asps is under their lips. Their mouth is full of curses and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. In their paths are ruin and misery, and the way of peace they have not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. And if we keep on going in verse 21, he gives a contrast. So therefore then the context of this is that there is a righteousness of God that is upheld in his justice and his vengeance against those who do not know him. But the sad truth is that no one seeks to know God. But in verse 21, 23, he says, but now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law. Those who do not know God are those who do not obey the gospel. What does it mean to obey the gospel? What has the gospel commanded of us that we might obey it? Believe. Faith. To be those who are the believing ones. I am holy, therefore be holy. We cannot. Jesus Christ is holy, so the gospel, if you look at it through the New Testament, look at it. Jesus Christ never has ever asked anyone to believe in him. He never has ever said, will you believe in me? He never has said, please come believe in me. I want you to get this, church. He has, because of his place of authority, all heaven, all earth, all authority over all things is his, and every essence of every place, of every time you hear Jesus say to believe, it is a command. Do you hear that? The gospel is not an offer to be chosen. The gospel is a command to be received and to be obeyed. And the bad news is we can't. Except God give us a heart to hear. Friends, if we are not believing on Christ alone, we do not know the one true God. And if we do not know the one true God, we are not His, and we will suffer the judgment of God's wrath in a flaming fire who inflicts vengeance. How will they suffer judgment? Look at verse 9. Punishment and eternal destruction. And this explainer, away from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of His might. In Revelation this past Tuesday, we answered the question about who could stand. In chapter 6 of Revelation, we see Jesus Christ take the decrees of God and is found worthy to open the decrees of all creation, the decrees of time. So that Jesus then becomes the commanding voice of that which God decrees. It's what we see in this imagery. If you want to know what that is, 3 weeks ago, go listen to it on the church website. I really encourage you to make it on Tuesday, or either at least listen to the class, reading of Revelation. And at the end of this text, we see in verse 12, when he opened the sixth seal, John says, I looked and behold, there was a great earthquake. The sun was gone. I'm just going to paraphrase it so you can understand it. The moon was gone. The stars were gone. The trees were gone. The sky was gone. The mountains were gone. The kings were gone. The generals were gone. The rich were gone. The powerful were gone. The slaves were gone. The free were gone. And the question there, quoting, there's the picture of those who desire to escape the judgment of Jesus Christ the Lamb. As the mountains were disappearing, they cry out, fall on us and hide us from the face of Him who is seated on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of their wrath has come, and who can stand? That question is answered in chapter 7. Who can stand? How will they suffer the judgment? They will suffer eternal justice. forever and ever, I think it's Revelation 18, forever and ever and ever, the smoke of their torment goes up and up and up. Jesus, in his day, spoke to the most horrific thing that people could comprehend. Fire that never went out. Darkness that was never shined light upon. Well, fire creates darkness, so we understand these are pictures. The worm never dies. Gnashing of teeth, screaming, wailing. And Jesus says it'll be worse than that. That those who are not saved by the grace of God through the hearing of the gospel of Jesus Christ will stand under the judgment of God, and they will be broken, and they will bow down before Jesus, and they will worship Him as Lord, but yet it will not be worship. It will be a command of the very essence of His being. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is Lord, for He is Lord, and no one can say that He's not Lord. We don't make Jesus our Lord. He is our Lord, even if we're in hell for all of eternity. He is our Lord. So if you think salvation comes through making Jesus Christ your Lord, you could very well have Him as Lord in eternal damnation. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. This intimate conversation with Jesus Christ, this intimate application of Him as our Lord and Savior. Well, He is everybody's Lord, but He is not everybody's Savior. He is only the Savior of those who believe. And friends, there is something that was plaguing the church in my childhood, and it's plaguing the church now, even in the name of Reformed doctrine, and that is this Lordship salvation baloney that teaches that if you just do things right in your life and you put Jesus on the throne of your life, you have eternal life. Well, let me tell you something, folks. Jesus is on the throne of everybody's life. And as the King sees fit to judge, His judgment is righteous and good. And if He judges us worthy to inherit the kingdom of God, we shall inherit it. If He judges us unworthy, we shall rightly be condemned for all of eternity. And that is one of these things that causes us great strain. Strain at church. Strain with it. Because the strain in trying to pull that together in our own minds, the frustration that comes when we try to make the gospel work in a worldly way or in a fleshly way or in a cognitive way, it doesn't work that way. The gospel is the good news of Jesus Christ. That's what it means. Evangel means good news. It is the good news that no matter how hard we try, we will fail. But God has accomplished perfectly salvation for His people. And that there is no condemnation for those who know God and who have obeyed the gospel, because God has effectively and efficiently satisfied His judgment against us through Jesus Christ the righteous. So then we are able to say, praise God from whom all blessings flow. For you are holy, 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 worthy, worthy, worthy. You are my all, you are my treasure, you are my King. We can say these things because God has secured us and sealed us with the Holy Spirit. We are able to say that we can stand under the judgment of God because there is no condemnation against us. Who are those that will stand? His saints. His church, His bride, His people, those who have obeyed the gospel by the work of God. 2 Corinthians 2:10. What does it say? For you are what? You have done well for yourself and created yourself in the image of Christ? No. It doesn't say you've tried hard and God's met you halfway. Nope. It doesn't say you believe by faith alone and then you really are producing some good fruit. Good a boy, good girl. Nope. It says, for you are God's workmanship. Beloved, rejoice in that. You are God's workmanship. There's too many books and too many sermons and too many DVDs, too many YouTube videos that teach everybody how to be like Christ in their own power and their own ability. When God is the one who makes us like Christ, God is the one who gives us the good news. God is the one who teaches us to obey. God is the one who produces these things. For you are God's workmanship, created how? In Christ Jesus to do what? Good works. What works? My works? No, the works that have been created beforehand for us to walk in. Let me tell you what that looks like. Here's James before Jesus doing good works. Teaching the Bible, praying, going to church, loving his neighbor, feeding the hungry, praying for the sick, visiting those in prison, giving cups of cold water in Jesus' name, and every act is wicked. It's all going to be punished. Those same acts in salvation are righteous. God takes us out of darkness and places us in the kingdom of light, puts us in the kingdom of His beloved Son, and therefore He places us into the works that are righteously effectual because that's His doing. That's hard for people. That's why as people age and get real cute and sweet and sit in chairs and rock, oh, there's no way Granny's not going to be with Jesus. Look how sweet she looks. Let me tell you something, brother. One of the sisters, one of the greatest evangelistic ministries is in those nursing homes. There's a lot of people die and go to hell there every day. And Jesse can attest, and Brother Brett, who most of you know, can attest that when they go in there, sometimes there are people who've been in there in their 90s who have never heard the gospel preached. They've been told, just do godly things. Just act godly ways. Just be in godly places. Hang around godly people. You're godly. Paul, quoting from the Psalms, says that we've all together become worthless together if we're not in Christ. Who will stand? Those who are believers. Those who will glory in His presence. Look at verse 10 there. When He comes on that day to be glorified, He will be glorified in His saints, and He will be marveled at among all who have believed. So those who glory in His presence, who bask in His majesty, who marvel at His glory, these are those who stand. These are those, friends, this is us. This is you if you have believed in Christ. This is you if you're trusting fully in Jesus Christ. Sola fide is not a point in history that we look back on. Sola fide is that which Jesus taught. Faith alone, faith alone, faith alone in Christ alone. If we don't have faith in Christ, we have nothing. And we can't compare ourselves to our neighbor. We can't compare ourselves to our pastor. We can't compare ourselves to the heathen. We can't compare ourselves to the deplorables. Pop culture. It invades everything. We can't compare ourselves to the wicked and say, look, oh, we're okay, because Jesus tells us a story about that very thing, does He not? That there are those who walk amongst the world during His day and their righteousness was of highest honor. He even says, if your righteousness is not greater than that of the Pharisees, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. And the Pharisee prays, and he thanks God for His righteousness. He thanks God that God has worked in him all these good works, and his trust is in his works, and his trust is in the fruit of his faith, and the faith of his faith. And the publican, the tax collector, that Jewish man who stole from his own people to line his own pockets, cried out, and tore his clothes, and beat his chest, and said, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Because that is the cry of one who realizes there is nothing that we can do in ourselves, nothing we can muster in our volition, nothing that we can produce out of our flesh that could please God. Jesus Christ in His flesh, as He lived holy and as He died righteously, is the only thing that will satisfy God for us. Those who believe are those who know God. Those who know God are those who are not rejected by God, even though it feels that way. Remember last week? Though we suffer, we feel out, where is God? God is in the midst of our suffering, for it is a gift from Him. It is a guarantee from Him. It is part of the evidence of our salvation, which is good judgment. Why is it righteous judgment of God to declare us just? Because He has suffered His Son on our behalf. Did you hear that? So that if Jesus Christ has truly paid for the sins of anyone, anyone whose sins have been paid for cannot be condemned. It is wicked. So for whom did Christ die? All the believing ones. That's what John 3 teaches. That's what Romans 3 teaches. That's what Ephesians 1 teaches. All the believing ones. Who are the believing ones? Those who know God and have obeyed the gospel. Who are they? Those who God has foreknown. Well, who are they? Beloved, I pray that's you. You hear the gospel today? In the day of judgment, those who are accepted by God, their suffering will cease. They shall hunger no more, neither shall they thirst, nor shall the sun strike on them, nor scorch them with heat. For the Lamb in the midst of the throne, He will be their shepherd, and He will give them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eye. Is that what you want, beloved? How will they stand? How do you know that you will stand before God justified? Look at the latter part of verse 10. When He comes on that day to be glorified in His saints and to be marveled at among all who have believed. I mean, those are sermon right there. I might do that again next week. But because our testimony to you was believed. What? What testimony? Oh, well, I used to be bad and now I'm saved. Is that a testimony? No. Well, I was lost and now I'm found. Is that the testimony? That's not what He's talking about. The testimony, even in that circumstance, is this. Jesus Christ the righteous has made me righteous and has satisfied God's judgment against me. For you were not destined unto wrath, but destined unto eternal life through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Friends, is your hope in Jesus Christ? Are you believing in Jesus Christ? Are you trusting in Jesus Christ? How are we to hear? How are they to hear? Romans 10. If no one preaches. Sadly, and then we'll quit. Sometimes we get very satisfied in our holy huddle. And we take for granted, remember what I started out with in the very beginning of the sermon, we take for granted that other people, just by their profession and by their lifestyle, that they are in Christ. And we think that the gospel is this evangelism message. Well, what New Testament letter was written evangelistically to unbelievers? None of them. New Testament was written to the church that they may be equipped and empowered, encouraged, and prepared to do the work of the ministry. So we preach the gospel not only to the lost, but we preach the gospel to each other. We share the gospel. We live the gospel. We remind each other of the gospel today. Friends, listen. Evangelism is not getting people to receive the gospel. Evangelism is teaching each other to obey the gospel. As they become God's children, as they become part of the local church. Missions without building the church is not biblical. Why? Because when you're saved, you are the church. Are you not? And what worse place to do? Go adopt the child and drop him off outside the trash cans. We just want to get you out of the orphanage. Hope you're okay. When we share the faith, when we share our testimony, we are encouraged as God's children, and the lost can be brought to salvation through our testimony. Do you share the gospel? I'll tell you, we all have opportunity to do so. And as we continue to learn in this text, we'll see that there is an impending urgency to do so. Before we close, I just got a matter that I want to share with the church while we're focused. Sister Pam, I don't know, it was a year or so ago? A year ago? 2 years ago. It's already been 2 years. Her brother has had trouble in the past and is a suspect and has been incarcerated and is standing trial this week as a suspect in a murder. And she needs prayer, the family needs prayer, mother needs prayer, and her brother needs prayer. It's difficult. I can't imagine. I mean, Doug, even as a husband, you can't really imagine what the family's going through, what somebody you love is being tried for something so heinous. And so I'm just asking us to pray for her, to pray for him, to pray for the family, to pray for justice, that it is done according to the will of God and that righteousness prevails, that even if her brother has to go to prison, that he might be a free man there through Jesus Christ. It's our prayer. Jury selection starts tomorrow, and according to the prosecution, it's going to be a pretty lengthy trial throughout the week, I think. It's going to be all week. And so I just want to make you aware of that. It's not something you really post on Facebook, you know, or send out emails on. And so with that, let's just go to the Lord in prayer, thanking Him for the Word and also praying for your family. What's your brother's name again? It slipped. Quentin. Let's pray. Our Lord, our God, our Father, our King, we praise You, Father, for just your mercy. And Lord, how when we in our human minds think about Your majesty and reflection of Your mercy, it seems such a polar opposite. But Father, You are so majestic in Your mercy. You are so glorious in Your mercy that You pour out judgment on the righteous one, on Your Son Jesus, the Christ, so that we could be free. And Father, we pray that the preaching of the Word today would just rest in us and empower us and give us life and joy and hope. And we pray that we would be just encouraged and compelled to share this good news with everyone, even if we don't know the details of how to explain all these things. Lord, let us simply say that Jesus suffered for my sin and in Christ I live. A simple phrase of powerful truth, and to call others to believe on Jesus as He commands them to, as we compel them to, as we urge them and plead with them to hear the command of Christ. This is good news. Jesus says, I am life. I am the way. I am the truth. And so, Father, it is in that gospel where we find the ability to pray for Quentin, Lord. Lord, for his family, for Pam and for Doug and the girls and her mother. Lord, it is in that gospel, in that good news, that we find the courage to stand, though we grieve, that we can say, Lord, please hear the pleas of our prayers and take righteousness to the highest level, that You would be exalted. And if this man did take a life, Lord, let the sentencing be equal to that which is necessary under our law, that You may prevail. But most importantly, Father, I pray You grant mercy upon his life. Lord, that You would spare him eternally. That this trial, that these things, that this justice would come to a place where the gospel would ring so hard in his mind that You would open his ears to hear, that You would give him eyes to see, and that his heart would be made ready for the seeds of grace that would be planted there, that You would bring to a great harvest, and that even if he goes to a penitentiary, Father, that he would be a beacon of glorious, gracious gospel. And Father, we pray for comfort during this time. We pray for the Hagen family, Lord, as they will be there and their hearts might be bitter and angry. We pray the gospel would come forth, that they would learn that forgiveness is at the cross of Jesus, and that no matter what we may have done under the laws of this land, Lord, we are all guilty of breaking Your law. Help us weep with them as they grieve, and help us rejoice with them as they see hope. And Father, I often don't, even in the circumstances I've been praying for 2 years, Lord, it just has gone by so quickly. Father, I just, Lord, we don't know what to pray. We don't know how to pray beyond what we've just said. And so, Lord, help us to pray. Pray in our weakness. Pray in the weakness of their family, like You've shown us in Scripture that Your Spirit does, Lord. Help us to come around them in prayer. And Lord, for those who are able to even be there as we can this week, in prayer during the trial, or Father, even there present during the trial, Lord, that Your gospel may have opportunity to be shared even during the recesses, during the witness testimonies. For God, You can do mighty things in the hearts of all men, women, and children. And we pray these things in the authority of Christ Jesus. We pray them, Lord, standing on the promises of Your covenant with us, on the promises of Your Word, on the promises of Your heart and of Your being. And we praise You, Father, for being a loving God and for doing all that You do for our good and for Your glory. And we pray these things in Jesus, in His precious name. Amen.